This one should work, too, though.
Whose's has a lot of experience. Maybe you should.
Oh, we've got it. There.
You got it?
All right. So I want to just do three different things. First, a few odds and ends about rules. And then I found the description by Graves and I guess his name is Hodge, I forget, about the how to construct an argument. And then since we still don't have a whole collection of samples from the students, I'm going to show you instead some writings of Richard Feynman. And I was just really struck this afternoon reading some of his papers at the fact that he completely follows Orwell's rules. He avoids the passive almost completely, except when it's necessary. And he just writes so clearly. It's just a pleasure to read what he writes. So let's see. Be nice to have a pointer, but I don't have a pointer. So one thing here is, I'm sure you know this, but just in case, let me just mention it. L-E-T apostrophe S means let us. On the other hand, L-E-T-S without the apostrophe means allows, as in Congress lets gun makers get away with murder. There's another rule that is frequently violated in speech, but I can't for the life of me think of an example, although one of my friends, in fact, two of my smartest friends, often make this mistake in casual speech. They're both from Minnesota, and this is apparently a Minnesota thing, but it's spread throughout the United States, and it's to repeat the verb to be, and typically is. Now, when Clinton said, it depends on what the meaning of the word is, that's correct. There's nothing wrong with that sentence. But some people say a sentence with the has is in it, and then repeat is in some funny way that I can't remember. Anyway, don't do it. All right, so that's the main thing. Those are the odds and ends. Now I want to find where I put the description of how to construct an argument. I forget where I put it. It wouldn't be there. It might be here. Probably not there or there. Okay. So it's probably at the end of this. Wait a minute, what is this? Oh gosh, hold on. Odds and ends, okay. Now. Somehow I thought I could automatically find, I forgot that I didn't know where I put this, and so let me just emphasize one thing that foreign students often screw up. Um, For example, how is an adverb? It cannot be used as the object of a preposition, of the preposition like. So you should never say how this looks like. You say what this looks like or how this looks. Similarly, where is an adverb? It can't be the object of the preposition at. So ask not where are you at, ask where are you. But where did I put the examples? Ah, it's simply principle 19 here. Hold on. Okay, this is it. So, the basic idea here is that the order of ideas in a sentence or a paragraph should be such that the reader need not rearrange them in his mind. I'm quoting Graves and his co-author, who, is it Hodge? Do you see that? Anyway, they write that the natural arrangement of ideas in a critical argument is, and I think this is worth either writing down or remembering it. It's principle 19 in the notes, the class notes, principle 19 of Graves et al. And so, in a critical argument, the natural arrangement of ideas is statement of problem, marshaling of evidence, first on main points, then on subsidiary ones. And then he says the same sequence kept throughout the argument, so don't change the order because you confuse the reader that way. Then you examine the credibility of evidence. You state the possible implications of all the evidence that is not wholly rejected. Then you bring in conflicting evidence and you weigh the conflicting evidence in the scale of probability, and then you come to a conclusion. And sometimes I remember reading articles that were arguing some point, I don't know, could be anything normally having to do with some political or social issue. And I would notice that they would bring in conflicting evidence and alternative viewpoints and discuss them and then typically reject them. And that was something that I never thought about doing when I was writing. I would always just say, what I think the evidence for this is, and ignore all contrary, all the opinions of anybody else, all conflicting evidence, just completely ignore it, and just say what I thought the actual rule was, or what the verdict should be. But anyway, this is apparently the conventional and approved way of proceeding in of constructing a critical argument. So you state the problem, marshal the evidence, main points, subsidiary points, keep the sequence the same throughout the argument, examine the credibility of the evidence, state the possible implications of all evidence not wholly rejected, weigh the conflicting evidence, and come to a verdict. Graves and his co-author also say something about how to conduct correspondence, and this, of course, is certainly less obligatory. Acknowledgement of previous letter, comments on the point raised in it in order of importance, the recipient's interests given priority, new information in order of importance, again, the recipient, the person you're writing to, that person's interest given priority, raising questions and then postscript. I don't quite know why he calls it a postscript, but postscript is normally after you finish the letter, but I guess that's what he means here. Any questions about this?
Postscript's what PS stands for, correct?
What?
Postscript is what PS stands for, correct?
Postscript is like when you write PS.
Yeah. So what does it mean when there's two S's? Because some people write PSS.
Oh. I don't know.
It's supposed to be PPS.
Does anybody know?
It's supposed to be PP. It's supposed to be PPS, post-postscript.
Yeah, that's what I have seen.
Yeah, not PSS.
Yeah, so it's just a mistake. Okay.
Okay.
Good question. Here, you're entitled to... Sorry. And since you answered it... it is Hodge. Graves and Hodge. Okay. So let's see. These are the two, I guess... other things that I was going to talk about, that I wanted to talk about, and now I think I'll just turn to some of Feynman's stuff to show you what really good scientific writing is like. And what I've done, before I get on to Feynman, let me mention something. In preparing for today's class, I chanced upon a book about scientific writing that is on the MIT website, and so I've added a link to it on the, so now the class website has a lot of links, and one of them is to a, of course we've got such a horrible internet at this university that I can't go immediately to that, to the class website, but presumably you can from home or somewhere else where you have a better internet connection. Anyway, it should be obvious on the webpage, on the class webpage, what the link is to the to an MIT book on scientific writing, and the book is probably 200 or 300 pages long, and it would be a place where you could, if you had a question that I haven't covered, or you want an alternative viewpoint to the viewpoint that I've been giving you, you could check it out in this MIT book. Now, other things that I put on this website were various books by various lectures and books by Feynman. So let me just here are three that I put up there today. One is an article by Feynman on using computers to simulate physics. And I think we could maybe look at the beginning of that article today and see, just as an example of how to write physics, how to write well scientifically. This is an article, by the way, that is quoted a lot as one of the founding articles of the field of quantum information theory. Now, I personally think that quantum information theory has been overly hyped. But this is a very good article. Then I've got FeynmanLectures.pdf. That's a PDF of the three-volume Feynman Lectures in Physics, and I got that today from bead-ok.org, which is a website where you can download all sorts of books. These downloads, though, are time-dependent. When the copyright owner finds out that people are downloading the book for free, they ask books-ok to delete the link, and the site deletes the link. So you can get Feynman's lectures today either from the class website or from B-OK. But if you wait a couple of years, it'll probably be gone, it may be gone. The third Feynman thing is called Selected Papers by Feynman. This is a collection that was edited by Laurie Brown, and it's a collection of some of the best or most important papers by Feynman, and you can download it also either from the class website or from B-OK. They're big files, though. Each one is 6,000-7,000 pages, something like that. But they're marvelous examples of superb science writing. So let me just sort of ask you, what would this? I've got 2,000 pages of Feynman's excellent writing here. What would you like to see? Let me just offer suggestions. We could read the beginning paragraphs of the paper on quantum information theory, or we could go to the Feynman lectures and jump to his description of quantum mechanics, or we could rummage around in selected papers by Feynman, which are papers on almost anything, because his range in physics was extraordinarily broad.
I'd be up for the quantum information one.
You'd like the quantum information or quantum mechanics?
Quantum information.
All right, well, let's get some other votes.
Yeah, that may be okay.
I didn't hear you.
Yeah, quantum information may be okay to look up.
All right. Okay, let's try that. It certainly the beginning. Let's make this bigger. And all right, it just fits. Okay, so shall I read it to you, or should we take turns reading it? I'll start reading it. On the program, it says this is a keynote speech, and I don't know what a keynote speech is. I do not intend in any way to suggest what should be in this meeting as a keynote of the subjects or anything like that. I have my own things to say and to talk about, and there's no implication that anybody needs to talk about the same thing or anything like it. So what I want to talk about is what Mike Dertusa suggested that nobody would talk about. I want to talk about the problem of simulating physics with computers, and I mean that in a specific way which I'm going to explain. The reason for doing this is something that I learned from Ed Fredkin, and my entire interest in the subject has been inspired by him. There's nothing to do with learning something about the possibilities of computers. It has to do with learning something about the possibilities of computers, and also something about possibilities in physics. If we suppose that we know all the physical laws perfectly, of course we don't have to pay any attention to computers. It's interesting, anyway, to entertain oneself with the idea that we've got something to learn about physical laws, and if I take a relaxed view here, after all I'm here and not at home, I'll admit that we don't understand everything. No, that's for sure. Okay, so who wants to start?
I'll start.
Okay, loud voice.
The first question is, what kind of computer are we going to use to simulate physics? Computer theory has been developed to a point where it realizes that it doesn't make any difference. When you get to a universal computer, it doesn't matter how it's manufactured, how it's actually made. Therefore, my question is, can physics be simulated by a universal computer? I would like to have the elements of this computer locally interconnected and therefore sort of think about the cellular automata.
Automata.
Automata as an example, but I don't want to force it. But I do want something involved with the locality of interaction. I would not like to think of a very enormous computer with arbitrary interconnections throughout the entire thing.
Okay, let me stop just for a moment and point out that almost every sentence has been the act of voice. And also, it's the writing is very clear. Also, he uses I, first person pronoun, as opposed to we or the passive voice. All right, why don't we go to you next?
Now, what kind of physics are we going to imitate? First, I'm going to describe the possibility of simulating physics in the classical approximation, a thing which is usually described by local differential equations. But the physical world is quantum mechanical, and therefore the proper problem is the simulation of quantum physics, which is what I really want to talk about. We'll come to that later. So what kind of simulation do I mean? There is, of course, a kind of approximate simulation in which you design numerical algorithms for differential equations and then use the computer to compute these algorithms and get an approximate view of what physics ought to do. That's an interesting subject, but it is not what I want to talk about. I want to talk about the possibility that there is to be an exact simulation. The computer will do exactly the same as nature. If this is to be proved, and the type of computer it is, as I've already explained, then it's going to be necessary that everything that happens in a finite volume of space and time would have to be exactly analyzable with a finite number of an amount of room.
Sorry, I was trying to arrange things on the screen a little bit better. Oh Lord, what is this doing?
Everything that happens in a finite volume of space and time would have to be perfectly, exactly analyzable with a finite number of logical operations. The present theory of physics is not that way. Apparently, it allows space to go down into infinitesimal distances, wavelengths to get infinitely great, terms to be summed in infinite order, and so forth. And therefore, if this proposition is right, physical law is wrong.
Okay, now here he's raising a rather dramatic possibility, namely that if you can describe physics in terms of computers the way he's thinking about it, we're going to have to change our understanding of physics. And of course, there is, or has been, for the past almost past 100 years, a problem in, well, past 150 years, there's been the problem of infinities in physics. And these infinities are associated in some way with discussing physics at arbitrarily short distances. In other words, treating particles as points rather than as extended objects. And if you take the charge of an electron and insist that it occupy an arbitrarily small volume of space, the electrostatic energy is infinite. And so he may be getting to in a way, he's thinking about getting beyond some of these difficulties. So let's see, who's next? You.
So good, we already have a suggestion.
Sorry. Go ahead. I just was trying to improve it.
Of a suggestion how we might modify physical law, and that it is the kind of reason why I like to study their sort of problem. To make an example, we might change the idea that space is continuous to the idea that space perhaps is a simple lattice and everything is discrete, so that we can put it into a finite number of digits, and that time jumps discontinuously. Now let's see what kind of physical work called it would be, or what kind of problem of computation we would have. For example, the first difficulty that would come out is the speed of light would depend slightly on the direction, and there might be other
anisotropies
to the physics that we would detect experimentally. It might be very small physical knowledge is, of course, always incomplete, and you can always say, we'll try to design something which beats experiment at the present time, but which predicts anisotropies on some scale to be found later. That's fine. That would be good physics if you could predict something consistent with all the known facts. It's just something new. It's just some new facts that we didn't explain. But I have no specific examples, so I'm not objecting to the fact that it's
anisotropic in principle.
Yeah, it's a question of how anisotropic. If you tell.
I just don't know what the. There it is, two fingers, that's it. Okay, you might as well finish the paragraph.
If you tell me it's anisotropic.
Well, there's a typo there. Anisotropic.
Anisotropic. I'll tell you about the experiment with the lithium atom, which shows that the anisotropy is less than that much, and that the hair theory of yours is impossible.
Right. Now. This here is slang, and he introduces it just to make it to make that a humorous expression.
Sir, Professor, I have a question there.
All right, hold on. Let me just arrange this. So, are you starting to read, or are you talking to me?
Yeah, I'm just asking a question. I have a question.
Yeah.
So can we go back on the last paragraph, Siri, before? The last paragraph,
yeah.
Siri. There is one phrase that was used to so and so. Right? You can see here in the last paragraph.
All right. Let's go back.
Actually, there is one phrase.
And it's so and so. If you tell me it's so and so anisotropic,
what
does so and so mean? He just means that the anisotropy is such and such. He uses so and so. I might have said such and such, but just meaning some particular anisotropy that you mentioned or that we could consider. In other words, any particular one that you're talking about or I'm talking about. It's such and such is just an English expression for meaning. It's almost like
I found
the anisotropy that you happen to have in mind.
Does that give any emphasis? Like,
I found a definition. It just calls it a thing whose name the speaker does not need to specify or does not know or remember.
Right.
So you want to talk about something, but you don't really need to.
Yeah, he doesn't want to say exactly why. And then he says, I'll tell you about the experiment with you, Adam, which shows that the anisotropy is less than that much, and that this here theory of yours is
possible. It does not to the extreme, right?
Yeah, that's it. It's not really the point to go into detail.
Okay, so let's see. Who's the next reader?
So another thing that had been suggested early was that natural laws are reversible, but that computer rules are not. But this turned out to be false. The computer rules can be reversible, and it has been a very, very useful thing to notice and to discover that. This is a place where the relationship of physics and computation has turned itself the other way and told us something about the possibilities of computation. So this is an interesting subject because it tells us something about computer rules and might tell us something about physics.
Okay, so next.
The rule of simulation that I would like to have is that the number of computer elements required to simulate a large physical system is only to be proportional to the space-time volume of the physical system. I don't want to have an explosion. That is, if you say, I want to explain this physics, I can do it exactly and I need a certain sized computer. If doubling the volume of space and time means I will need an exponentially larger computer, I consider that against the rules. I make up the rules, I am allowed to do that. Let's start with a few interesting questions.
Okay, so, do you want to continue with this particular article, or just download it and read it at home? Or shall we go on to the Feynman lectures in physics about quantum mechanics or something else?
I don't really mind that, by the way. It's an interesting article.
You want to stay with this one?
I'd be all right.
I think it's too long to go.
Okay. I read a certain amount of it this afternoon, and the part that's fun to read and easy to understand, I think we're just about getting to the end of it. But okay, go for it.
First, I'd like to talk about simulating time. We're going to assume it's discrete. You know that we don't have infinite accuracy in physical measurements, so time might be discrete on a scale of less than 10 to negative 27 seconds. You'd have to make it at least like to this to avoid clashes with experiment, and make it 10 to negative 41 seconds if you like, and then you've got us.
Well, it's a short paragraph. Why don't you do another one?
One way in which we simulate time in cellular automata, for example, is to say that the computer goes from state to state. But really, that's using intuition that involves the idea of time. You're going from state to state, and therefore the time, by the way, like the space in the case of cellular automata, is not simulated.
Automata.
Is not simulated at all. It's imitated in the computer.
Okay, so until it's your turn.
Yeah. An interesting question comes up. Is there a way of simulating it rather than initiating it? Well, there is a way of looking at the world that is called the space-time view. Imagining that the points of space and time are laid out, so to speak, ahead of time, and then we could say that computer would be in quotes because it's not the standard kind of computer which operates in time. Is we have a state Si at each point I in space-time, C(1). The state Si at the space-time point I is given function Fi of Sj, Sk, etc. Of the state at a given point J, K in some neighborhood of I. Si is equal to Fi, Sj, comma, etc., comma, Sk, comma, etc.
So here's this picture.
you'll notice immediately that if this particular function is such that the value of the function at I only involves the few points behind the time earlier, then this time I, all I've done is to describe the cellular automaton, because it means that you calculate a given point, you calculate a given point from points at earlier times, and I can compute the next one and so on. And I can go through this in that particular order. But just let us, does the people say that?
Oh yeah, that's a typo.
Yeah, but anyways, but just...
So we could have used let's, you could drop the us, just let's think,
yeah, but
or
let's,
just let us think.
But let's think of a more general kind of computer, because we might have a more general function. So let's think about whether we could have a wider case of generality of interconnections of points in space-time. If F depends on all the points, both in the future and in the past, then
what then?
That could be the way physics works.
Okay, let me just interrupt. By the way, Feynman Feynman was a graduate student at Princeton, and his supervisor was Wheeler, and together, or maybe just Feynman, I don't remember. It must have been together, because I think it was Wheeler's viewpoint that you could think of electrodynamics, and in particular quantum electrodynamics, in a space-time way in which positrons were electrons going backward in time. And I think he even considered the possibility that it's just one electron and that it's going forward in time and backward in time, and that all these electrons are just this particular particle crossing t equals zero, where we are now, a zillion times, and those are all the electrons.
What year was it to think of this?
What?
What year did Wheeler think of this?
Oh, I don't know. I would guess late 40s.
Oh, okay.
All right, so let's go.
I didn't finish it. I'm still in the middle of the paragraph. Yes, so that could be the way physics works. I'll mention how our theories go at the moment. It has turned out in many physical theories that the mathematical equations are quite a bit simplified by imagining such a thing, by imagining positrons.
By imagining positrons?
Yeah, positrons. As electrons going backwards in time, and all other things that connect objects forward and backwards. The important question would be, if this computer we all laid out, is there in fact an organized algorithm by which a solution could be laid out that is computed? Suppose you know this function f.
Gone through a huge bout. Why don't you try to finish the paragraph?
Suppose you know this function f and
f sub
I, and it is a function of the variables in the future as well. How would you lay out numbers so that they automatically satisfy the above equation? It may not be possible. In the case automatically satisfy...
In the case of the cellular automaton, it is.
In the case of the cellular automaton, it is, because from a given point, from a given row, you get the next row, and then the next row, and there's an organized way of doing it. It's an interesting question, whether there are circumstances where you can, where you get functions for which you can't think, at least right away, of an organized way of laying it out. Maybe sort of shake it down from the approximation or something, but it's an interesting different type of computation. Question, doesn't this reduce to the ordinary boundary value and opposed to initial value type of calculation? Answer, yes, but remember this is the computer itself that I'm describing. It appears actually that that classical physics is casual.
Causal.
You can, in terms of the information in the past, if you include both momentum and position, or the position at two different times in the past, either way, you need two pieces of information at each point, calculate the future in principle. So classical physics is local, causal, and reversible, and therefore apparently quite adaptable, except for the discreteness and so on, which I already mentioned, to computer simulation. We have no difficulty in principle, apparently, with that.
Okay, let me just switch now and just show you what there is, what these other two files are like. In particular, the Feynman lectures, whoops. Feynman played the bongo drums, that's why the photo's there. So let me just draw your attention to, that's strange. Oh, I went too fast, hold on. So the stuff on quantum mechanics, which I'd encourage you to read, you can either read it on the screen or, if you want, download the whole 1,000 pages. I'm trying to get to where it starts, and somehow the numbering is different from the way I remember it. Well, anyway, I just suggest that you look at these Feynman lectures on physics. They're examples of excellent writing and excellent scientific writing. There is my own personal experience reading the Feynman lectures is that it was that they're more difficult than they would be if Feynman had been an ordinary physicist. In reality, he was so smart and so creative that he, in his Feynman lectures in physics, for each subject that he considered, he invented a new physics that was suited exactly to the problem that he was discussing. So if you go from chapter, say, 20 to 21, the viewpoint, the physics viewpoint is different in 20 from the one in 21 and or 22 or whatever. And each time he formulates physics in such a way that the problem becomes as clear as possible. But what I found a little bit jarring is that the physical rules and equations and principles change from chapter to chapter because he's picking out the ones that give the clearest description of the physics. On the other hand, it's as I said, it's these are three books of excellent physics writing. And the other thing, let me just bring the other thing up for just a second. The other one, selected papers, it's also long, so it takes a few seconds for the computer to pull the thing up. But you can look through it and find all kinds of papers by him on different topics. And they're arranged in a rather neat way here. Curiously, they start with some quantum chemistry, then classical and quantum electrodynamics, classical electrodynamics, quantum electrodynamics. That's what he got the Nobel Prize for, was quantum electrodynamics. Path integrals and operator calculus, liquid helium, and then some stuff on elementary particles. He and Gell-Mann invented the modern theory of, well, modern as of 1960 or 1950 or 60, that version of the theory of the weak interactions. And then later he invented partons, which became an important phenomenological technique for discussing the strong interactions. He did fundamental work in quantum gravity. And then the last thing, 921, is probably the paper that we've just been reading. I don't remember what it is.
It's what year you said this paper? 19 what?
Which paper?
The one we were reading.
Oh, the one we were reading was 1981.
Oh, okay.
And it was published in 82.
Okay.
In a journal we don't have access to. I had to get it through interlibrary loan. Okay, so this, you guys are telling me that this is the last class because next Monday is exam week, is that right?
Yeah.
All right, so we'll forget about next Monday. And I don't remember, is this pass fail?
Credit, no credit.
Huh?
Credit, no credit.
Okay, credit, no credit. Yeah, okay, so you'll get credit. All right, well, have a nice summer, and feel free to download or to look at the stuff on the class webpage. It's too bad we couldn't have more examples of your writing, which we could have discussed in class, but that's just the way the cookie crumbled. So I guess you can turn it off. Okay, who is starving and needs some...